All right, there we go. Now we're up and running. All right, is everybody ready to go?
Yes.
Sure.
All right, well, welcome to this lecture. It's called Pharmacology and Cardiology. We're just kind of examine the interactions between the two today. What we'll start off with is a case study. And if you just kind of work this with me here. You arrive on scene to find a 47-year-old male sitting at his desk in an office. The patient is complaining of persistent, severe chest pain that started as he was working. The patient is pale and diaphoretic. The patient's vital signs are a heart rate of 120, respirations of 24, and a BP of 130 of 88. What do you do next?
Put him on the monitor.
Put him on the monitor. That's a good idea. They shoot a 12-lead EKG, and it's showing that this patient's having a heart attack. So, does anybody know the heart attack drugs off the top of their head?
Aspirin.
Nitro.
Morphine.
Morphine. And oxygen. What's the acronym for that?
Mona.
Mona. So, just take a look at these. You have aspirin. It's a non-steroid anti-inflammatory. But what does aspirin do to help with heart attack symptoms? Yeah. And it keeps the platelets from sticking together. And, maybe offer some pain relief, 45 minutes from now. Your dose is 324 milligrams, or 325 if you get to take it all in one tablet. I once had that debate with a nurse. Nitroglycerin is a vasodilator and an antihypertensive. And so, what's that do when you give somebody nitroglycerin? Dilates the blood vessels, drops the BP. Exactly. Anybody know the dose off the top of their head?
0.4
milligrams. Per spray, per tablet. Morphine sulfate. What do we give that for?
Pain.
Right, and it also has a vasodilation effect. Anybody know the dose off the top of their head?
4 milligrams.
Yep, start with 4 milligrams. Increase in increments of 2 up to 10. So, out of those drugs, I want you to think about it. Which one of those do you think is going to have the most noticeable effect on the heart rhythm for that patient?
Nitro.
Why do you say nitro?
Well, the baby's nitro.
Morphine.
Morphine? Yeah, I think you're right. I think it's going to be morphine because of those the pain-relieving effects. So, if the heart rate was at 110, what would you expect it to drop down to?
Oh, 90.
Hopefully 90, maybe, something like that. Yeah, I wouldn't expect a drastic change, but you'd hopefully see a trend from going a little bit fast to slow. So, this right here is basically what we're going to be doing for the next 40 minutes or so. We're going to look at the interactions between cardiology and pharmacology related to some different patient case studies. Our objectives for today are as follows. We're going to examine the different types of EMS medications that you use and how you treat different cardiac emergencies with them. You're going to investigate the effects of some common prescription drugs and some illicit drugs you're going to see out there and see the kind of effects that they're going to have on the heart rhythm. We're going to explore some electrolytes and how they can alter the cardiac rhythm when they're administered. And hopefully we're going to gain a general knowledge of various EMS medications that alter the cardiac rhythm. There's some in there that have cardiac effects that I'm not sure everybody knows about, but hopefully after today you will. And along the way, with the help of our handy-dandy, almost two-legged sim man, we're going to monitor some of the effects of the medications. So hopefully we're going to have a running tally here of how the rhythm changes. We'll watch the monitor screen. So, before we get too far into this, does everybody remember the cardiac electrical conduction system?
Yes.
All right. Just in case.
You can show us.
I'm just going to show you anyway. I have to show you anyway because I already drew the heart. All right. so starting up here, what do we have?
SA.
Or SA note. We go down to what's here?
AB
junction, AB node spreads out to the
left and right
bone branches, and on the end is the. Keep this in mind today because a lot of stuff that we're talking about, these drugs are going to affect different parts of the system. So keep that fresh in your mind. All right, so let's move on to this case study. You're going to respond to a 70-year-old female who experienced a syncopal episode in the Walmart Eye Care Center. Upon patient contact, she was alert and oriented. The patient states she feels weak and dizzy when she stands up. The patient says that she had had a previous episode of this occur last week. She's not taking any medications today. She states that she has a history of heart disease. Her vitals are as follows. Heart rate of 40, respirations of 24, BP of 88 over 68. What jumps out of those vitals?
At 40.
Oh, heart rate of 40. Good job. Good spot. What else looks a little suspect? That BP, that low BP. So, I know y'all have been taught to go for pacing. But since this is a pharmacology-related cardiology class, let's say this patient is stable enough that they can be treated with medication. What are you going to reach for to try to treat this patient's bradycardia if it looks like so let's go ahead and administer this guy atropine so the alarm's won't keep going off. So atropine is an anticholinergic. Have y'all learned about the whole acetylcholine, rest and digest side of the nervous system? When you're given atropine, you're sort of countering that. So, you're waking them up and, have them run around as opposed to it's going to increase the firing of the SA node, specifically. And it's going to counter vagus nerve responses. So y'all ever talked about how, somebody's sitting on the toilet and they stimulate their vagus nerve and they go into bradycardia and fall off and they wedge themselves in between the toilet and the shower?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Atropine specifically can help counter those vagus nerve stimulation responses. So, because it can increase the firing of that SA node, it can sort of counter the vagus nerve response. That makes it, a decent medication to increase the heart rate. So, have you been told about not using atropine in your second, third degree heart loss?
Yeah.
Okay. The reason why is because it works in the SA node. You may stimulate the SA node to fire faster, while the ventricular rhythm that's being generated is still doing its own thing, so you can scramble up their heart rate even more. So if you do find a heart block, I would be cautious administering atropine. In fact, I would personally administer it. So that's when you go for your pacing. Another aspect if you're going to administer atropine is if you push it too slow, it kind of it has a mild effect on the vagus nerve and it actually stimulates bradycardia. Also, if you give it in too small of an amount, it has the same effect. So, if you don't push your atropine fast enough at the correct dose, you're going to get, y'all know the fancy term for it? The paradoxical effect. You get the opposite response of what you're looking for. So, if you do find a patient with sinus bradycardia, atropine, depending on the cause, may be a good medication to try to speed up. All right, so let's move on to this case study here. You're dispatched to a Walmart on the other side of town. You arrive on scene to find a 54-year-old male sitting in a booth at the Walmart McDonald's. The patient is pale, diaphoretic, nauseous, and complaining of chest pressure. The patient's vital signs are as follows. A heart rate of 190, respirations of 28, BP of 94 over 60. So, what jumps out about that?
Their vital signs.
Specifically, which one?
Heart rate.
The heart rate of 190. So now we take a look at the blood pressure. How's that look to you?
A little low,
trying to compensate. If the patient's talking to you with these vitals, how do you think you're going to treat him first? If he has this rate on the monitor. Vagal maneuvers, like we just talked about with the vagus nerve, but say that doesn't work.
Is it right nerve?
Yeah, it's
narrow complex. Narrow complex at rate 190. Starting here, what's adenosine, 6 milligrams. If the 6 milligrams doesn't work, how many times can you repeat it and what does?
12.
Twice.
Yep. So you go 6, 12, and 12. So just a little bit about adenosine. It's an antiarrhythmic. Adenosine works specifically targeting the AV node. So it's just going to block the impulses that are generated there, the AV node, creating a little period of asystole. It's like hitting the reset button. It's kind of like defibrillating, but you're doing it chemically, where you're just kind of, you know, stopping all the activity in the heart for a second. You know, the adenosine's going to wear off very quickly and see if it returns back to a normal rate. I know we use 6, 12, and 12, and when you push it, you kind of, you know, you get a little nervous when you see the heart rate go from that to that for a few seconds. You start getting a little nervous, little beads of sweat start forming, you start reaching your hand towards an epi. But then hopefully it comes back at a comfortable rate. Say it like 110. And if you feel nervous about it, think about I saw a presentation from a neurosurgeon. They use adenosine to stop the heart to give them a few seconds to try to fix bleeding in the head. They pushed 24 milligrams of adenosine. That's a pretty sizable gap there of asystole that they had to work with. So, yeah, we think 12 milligrams is bad, but I think 24, I would definitely have my hand on that number too. So a lot of times you think of adenosine can be a diagnostic tool for fast rhythms. Sometimes, if it's a straight up supraventricular tachycardia, hopefully you'll convert it back to a more manageable rate. But sometimes it won't convert, but you will have a brief period, you know, when you cause that asystole, but then the heart starts back up, that you can actually determine what type of narrow complex tachycardia it is. So if you administer the adenosine, it can give you a window where you can find out if you're dealing with AFib or a fast AF flutter or some kind of super fast sinus attack. You can kind of use adenosine as a diagnostic tool when you administer it and you're looking at the monitor. So not only does it correct SVT, you can use it to diagnose what specific type of fast rhythm you're in if it doesn't fix itself. Does that make sense? Now it's preferred for SVT. If you're pretty sure that you're looking at SVT, you're going to want to push the adenosine because they like research has shown that they use alternative medications. If the patient's blood pressure is low, if they bring the rate down slowly, it causes the blood pressure to drop. Whereas if you push the adenosine, you have that brief drop. They feel pretty bad, but when they come back, their blood pressure picks back up. So you have less danger of causing dangerous hypertension treating with the adenosine. So one of the options that does pop up if you're trying to treat a narrow complex tachycardia is a calcium channel blocker. Now, do you know what specific rhythm they prefer that you use the calcium channel blocker for? Like cardiocyte, those high speed. AFib, yeah, A-flutter. What calcium channel blockers do are they relax the heart muscle and the blood vessels. Y'all remember going over the inotropic, chronotropic, and dromotropic effects? Let me refresh your memory. Inotropic is how hard the heart is squeezing. So if it has a negative inotropic effect, it means that it's making the heart squeeze less with each contraction. If it's got a negative chronotropic effect, chronotropic refers to like straight up like heart rate. So if it's if your heart rate's being at 120, and you push a medication that has a negative chronotropic effect, it'll drop the heart rate down. And then dromotropic refers to like how effective it is at causing conduction through the AV junction. Dromotropic is sort of like the weirdest one to keep track of, but it's like, it affects on how many impulses they allow to come through that AV junction. That's the dromotropic effect. So if calcium channel blockers have a negative effect on all three, what's your overall effect on the heart? Slows it down. It usually slows it down nice and gradually, so there's not a drastic change. And by doing that, it reduces your oxygen consumption in the heart, makes the burden on the heart less. And also, it's got some vasodilation effects, so those coronary arteries on the heart, those are widened as well, makes it a little bit more effective pump. So your dose for calcium channel blockers kind of varies. Depending on where you work in the state. By our state protocols, typically you're going to give a dose of initially 20 milligrams IV. A lot of places say that if you're under 60 years old, you're going to half that and you only get 10 milligrams. But overall, if you kind of operate on the principle of you never want to give more than 0.25 milligrams per kilogram for a patient, that's sort of like, that's the AHA national dose they put out. But here in North Carolina, you're going to stick with that either the 20 or the 10. So, yeah, calcium channel blockers, you're going to want to check with your agency protocols because sometimes the dosage may vary. So, talking about the effects that calcium channel blockers can have, what happens if grandma with dementia opens up her pill caddy full of calcium channel blockers and takes an entire week's worth at one time? Yeah, it's going to go way down. Because all those negative chrono and dromotropic effects are going to happen at the same time. So if that happens, what do? Give her calcium. Most points. What kind of substance is calcium in the EMS world? An electrolyte. It's one of those electrolytes that works in the heart to keep balance of things, make sure it's running smoothly. So, it's a pretty simple principle. If they've taken too many calcium channel blockers, you're going to try to flood it with a little bit of extra calcium. And hopefully, because sometimes calcium channel blockers target specific types of calcium channels. So the hope is you give them a little bit of extra calcium, maybe that can give them a boost for the calcium channels they have left and counter the effects of the blocker effects. So just kind of keep this concept in your head of like, if an electrolyte is being blocked, you want to try to increase the amount of that electrolyte to see if you can work your way around the block. That may pop up a little bit later. So, just to clarify one more time, adenosine versus calcium channel blockers, which one do you use on what rhythm? Right, adenosine for SVT, calcium channel blockers for AFib. Now, there's nothing wrong if you give adenosine and you find out that the patient's in AFib, because you just use that as a diagnostic tool. It's totally fine. But usually, they like the calcium channel blockers specifically. All right. So let's move on to this next step. You're dispatched to Walmart on the north side of town you haven't visited yet for an unconscious call. You find a 56-year-old male sitting on a bench in the garden center. He states he feels like his heart is racing. He says he sat down on the bench and called 911 because he felt like he was going to pass out. His vital signs are as follows. He's got a heart rate of 140, respirations of 20, and a BP of 94 over 70. So what would you be suspicious of? Alright, so let me show you this patient's rhythm when you put him on the cardiac monitor.
That would be better.
Oh!
He did that on purpose.
What we got on the monitor then?
VTAC!
What type of VTAC is this?
With a pulse.
VTAC with pulses! So, take a look at this patient's vital signs. Do you think this patient's stable or unstable?
Stable enough.
Maybe a little bit talking. Yeah, talking to us. Blood pressure's low, but not like, you know, crossing like, you know, that threshold of 90. So, what is going to be your first medication you use to try to treat this?
Amiodarone.
There you go. Amiodarone, an antiarrhythmic. It slows the conduction rate of the SA and AV nodes. And over the entire heart, it kind of prolongs the refractory period. You know, that kind of like that time it takes for the heart to recharge and fire again. It's primarily used to target ventricular arrhythmias, which you got right here on the monitor. We've already identified the type of VTAC. You know, pretty stable with a pulse. So what is our dose going to be to treat this patient? 150 milligrams with that caveat of over 10 minutes. All right. You got that part right. So who actually knows the recipe down cold for making an amiodarone? 150 milligrams of amiodarone in what size fluid bag do you think?
50.
You can either use a 50cc or a 100cc. I've seen both used. So, what you do is you use a formula specifically for fluid administration. Like, what you have to do is, you know, you put your amio in either of these, so all you have to do is administer this amount of fluid over 10 minutes. So for this formula to work, you only need three things. You need your total volume of fluid over the total time in minutes. Times your drop factor. So that's when I say drop factors, you're choosing which drip set you're going to. I would recommend a 10-drop set for amiodarone. I'll show you why. So, terrible. Let's set up like this. are 50 cc's.